like I said, and I keep saying throughout this whole course, I said that marriage is an emotional meeting relationship. Never ever forget that. That is what marriage is all about. So the day you forget this, you're going to make a mess of your marriage. You are in it to meet the other person's emotional need. Once that person's emotional need is not being met, there'll be friction and vice versa. So whenever you feel that, you know, your spouse is not really meeting your emotional needs, there is a way to attention him, to bring his attention or notify him. You say, honey, hey dear, I feel that this that is not being met adequately, you know. You draw his attention to that. Or whenever you want to feel loved or something, there's a way you communicate that to your spouse, you know. And at times you feel that, oh, you're so lovey-dovey that you want to express it to your spouse. The way all those things are done, the way you communicate that you need it, you need to be loved or shown some love, or the way you want to also show or communicate to your spouse that you love him or you love her, is what we call love language. So like in the human race, we have different people speak different languages. We have English, we have German, we have Igbo, we have all those kind of languages. You know, people use it to communicate how they feel and to communicate meaning to other people. That same way, love has different ways through which you can communicate it. Either communicating that you mean it or communicating the way you feel for someone. So that is basically what love language is all about. And there are about five of them that we know. There are five basic ones that we know. And there are different ways. So there are people have written books on that. 10 ways to communicate love effectively, 25 ways to communicate love effectively, 15, 20 ways to communicate love effectively, but all categorized under five basic headings. And that is why, and that is what we are going to look at today. Remember our key scripture, Proverbs 24. Why are we doing this? Knowledge, understanding, then wisdom. All right, the first love language is words of affirmation. Words of affirmation. Words are critical. We cannot overemphasize it. Neither can I underemphasize it. You know, the whole world as it is was created by the word of the Lord. God said it and it became. That means that words are creative in nature. You know, it's something we need to know for sure. Words create. You know, something that doesn't exist can be brought into existence through words. So words are powerful. Jesus speaking said that the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So words are powerful. So words are things that everybody should be careful with. Think before you speak. Choose your words rightly before you use them, especially when you are in an emotional relationship with somebody. That little tongue in your mouth can set on fire somebody's life, somebody's destiny. So that's how powerful words are. We need to be careful with our choice of words. The Bible says, "He that speaketh like the piercing of a sword." That's the way you speak, and your words actually pierce the heart of who you are speaking to. No, just say something. Don't call anybody a racker. Don't call anybody a fool. You know, you say anybody that does that is already, you know, at the danger of hell. That is how powerful words are. So words of affirmation is a good way to express love. It's a good love language, especially to women, because women fall in love with their ears. Women, because they are emotional feelers. When we look at the male and female differences, you will talk more on that. Women are emotional feelers. Women communicate how they feel, communicate or speak from their feelings. Men communicate what they think. Women communicate how they feel. So because of that, they're emotional creatures. So words that you speak to them or use on them are very, very, very important. They are in constant need to be affirmed. Every man must understand this. They're in constant need to be affirmed. Now, I used to find it a little challenging with my wife, you know, at the beginning, because she's constantly wanting me to affirm her. She will ask me, "Do you love me?" You know, out of the blues, "Do you love me?" I'm like, "Excuse me, no, I love you." like, yeah, I should say it now that she wants to hear. I'm like, well, you know now, why should I say it? And I used to argue with her, you know, but that is how women are. We need to understand it. They constantly want to be affirmed. They constantly want to hear it. They constantly, it makes them feel good. It makes them, you know, tick. You know, it is what oils their engine. So constantly do that. Let them know they look good, they look fine, they're doing well. Whenever they walk all through the house, you know, keeping the house and all that, they want to know that they've done a good job. You let them know, say, oh, you've done a good job, thank you. Oh, you're a great woman, thanks for helping out, thanks for cleaning up, thanks for taking care of the children. Oh, this food is beautiful, it's yum, 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 yum. Even if it is not, just say it. It makes her feel good. It gives her the impetus to try again. You know, it triggers her to make more effort so she can hear it said again that she's doing well. So don't hoard words of affirmation for you towards a woman. Please don't do that. Constantly encourage them. And whenever you're upset or angry over something, please don't bust out and rattle and spill your guts and say all sorts of things that you might regret the next day. Carefully think about what you want to say, choose your words right, and deliver it. And you will get the best out of that woman when you do that. So I'm going to hurry. I want to see if I can make this a 30 minutes class. So the next one is quality time. Quality time, quality time, quality time. Beautiful, quality time. You know, quality time is not quantity time. Quality time is spending time with your spouse when nothing else distracts the two of you. You know, it is giving undivided attention to your spouse. You know, it does not really mean sitting down watching TV together, though it's part of it. But that TV is already a distraction. Yes, it may be her favorite show, your favorite show. It's good to spend that kind of time together. But beyond that, also make sure that the two of you, you know, enjoy that moment together. That the two of you spend time together. That the two of you connect at an emotional level, you know. When you're even discussing about the things you're watching, try to relate it to the two of you. Though you're watching TV, you know, try to relate it to your relationship together. That turns that quantity time into quality time. You know, it's one of the things, quality time, one of the things that really bring, you know, that sense of togetherness, you know, between two people. So it's also a very, very, very important love language. The third one is receiving gifts. Everybody likes gifts. The receiving gifts is a good love language. I'm yet to meet a woman that does not like receiving gifts. I don't know if they exist. If you're watching this and you think they exist, please let me know. Every woman likes herself some gift, and it mustn't really be something expensive. You know, when you give gifts to somebody that you love, it just tells that person that you are thinking about him or her, especially if you give that gift outside an occasion, not at birthdays, not during Christmas, not during Easter, not during one, you know, festival and a ceremony like anniversary, but out of the blues, buy something nice for your spouse, and it communicates a whole lot of stuff to your spouse. The fourth one is acts of service. Help, assist, you know, your spouse, you know, more often than not, especially at home. You know, if you can also assist in that person's career or business or whatever, do that. Acts of service is good. Men, help your wives in the kitchen. Cut up something, cut the onions, don't let her, you know, don't let tears come out of her eyes. Cut the onions, blend one or two things that she's cooking while you get in the kitchen. Help her out. Take out the trash. Take out the garbage. Help her home. Take care of the kids. Maybe she has worked all day and she's had it up here, and the kids are home bellowing and bemoaning, and she does not want all of that. Offer to take care of the kids for her. Those are acts of service that the woman wants. And on the flip side, men, of course, thrive, live on acts of service. They want everything clean and proper in the house. When the man was a bachelor, his house was totally unkempt. You know, one shirt hanging there, this one hanging there, everything upsy-tovy at home. But this same man that is totally untidy, once he marries, I don't know what enters our head. We want to come into a house that is clean, spick and span, everything in place. We just want magic. Somebody to stand in the middle of the house, wave a magic wand, and everything flies to its place and into the closet. You know, men thrive on this. So women also understand that. So go the extra mile. Go the extra mile to keep the house tidy and neat, you know, for that man. You know, and the fifth one is physical touch. The one talk about physical touch we're not really talking about lovemaking. It goes beyond lovemaking. There's a lovemaking that does not involve coitus, you know, that does not involve intercourse. You know, the woman might be cooking at the kitchen, you go hug her from the back, peck her, and that's it. You know, she'll be doing something, you just go brush your hand against her back. You know, those kind of touch that does not end up in having sex. It's very, very important. It's a good love language, you know. It is something that should be practiced between couples, you know. And do it unexpectedly, when the person least expects it. You know, a careful stroking of her hair, rubbing her cheek, sends and communicates a whole lot to her. It is something that should be practiced more often than not. You know, don't let every smooshing end up with sex. She might just want you to hold her and just tell her sweet nothings while she sleeps. I don't think whenever she says holds me that she wants sex. Don't ever think that whenever she says, oh please, can you just rub my back, that she wants sex. You know, man, every for men, everything we think is sex. I see we are sex crazy. But a woman does not think that way. You know, women feel it, most times even feel more fulfilled by all those careless touches that does not end up in sex than this act itself. And that is the end of the course. God bless you. Make sure you subscribe to my channel and look at the other masterclasses on relationship that I have. And very soon I'm going to have masterclass on success coming soon. So you make sure you hit me up. Subscribe to my channel so you get a notification whenever a new class is uploaded. God bless you.